Good afternoon, everyone. Welcome. Thank you for your patience. My name is Sikine El-Khayoubi. I'm your host today. And also, I'm a journalist and lecturer at the University of Applied Sciences, Windesheim, in Zwolle. In Dutch, we say Hogeschool Windesheim. And as you can hear me speaking, this session will be held in English because our keynote speaker is from the UK. And we're going to listen to a very interesting presentation. It's titled Breaking News is Broken. Fake News, AI, and the Case for Slow Journalism by none other than Rob Orchard. After the presentation, there will be room for sharing your ideas. So if you have any questions in mind, please wait after the presentation. There'll be enough time for questions. Rob Orchard is the editor and co-founder of the British magazine Delayed Gratification and has an extensive experience in slow journalism. He'll be sharing today his insights on this topic and how the internet has become a disinformation dystopia. Interesting words. How lies online spill out into the real life of people and how slow journalism can be a cure for this problem. So, thank you for joining us today. And Rob, take it away.
Thank you very much. Hello, everybody. I'm sorry to be another English person coming to the Netherlands and speaking in English. I'm going to try and make it worth your while. My rubbish with languages, so... Hello, everyone. My name's Rob Orchard, and back in 2011, I co-founded Delayed Gratification, the world's first slow journalism magazine. Our idea was to provide an alternative to knee-jerk breaking news production by returning to big stories after the dust had settled to answer the question of what happened next. We wanted to help our readers to navigate a world that was becoming increasingly complex and insecure. It was our own small line in the sand, a declaration of intent in a news environment that seemed to be in serious decline. It has been an extraordinary time to be running a news magazine. We've had the Arab Spring and the Occupy movement, the killing of Osama bin Laden and Black Lives Matter, the news of the world shut down by phone hacking, and Julian Assange holed up in the Ecuadorian embassy in London, the annexation of Crimea, MH17, MH370, and German wings, Ebola, Zika, ISIS, Brexit, North Korea hacking Sony to try and force them to cancel a comedy movie featuring Kim Jong-un, Charlie Hebdo, the Bataclan, and the Manchester Arena bombing. Amazing medical and technological advances. Wildfires in the Amazon and in the Arctic. Me Too and the fall of Harvey Weinstein. Civil war in Syria and Libya. A third of the world's population confined to their homes. The President of the United States of America musing that injecting disinfectant might help to free the body of a coronavirus during a pandemic that may or may not have been caused by somebody in China eating a pangolin. Barnard Castle, the murder of Jamal Khashoggi, the lambasting of J.K. Rowling. Elon Musk launching a perfume that smells of burnt hair to help fund the purchase of Twitter, taking over as CEO and then polling all of the users of Twitter to see if he should almost immediately step down. The storming of the US Capitol, the storming of the Brazilian Congress, the invasion of Ukraine, the launch of the James Webb Telescope, the overturning of Roe v. Wade, Agatha Christie, the brief and tragic premiership of Liz Truss, and the devastating earthquakes in Turkey and Syria. And while all of this has been going on, our information ecosystem has become ever faster and more intense, driven by an obsession with breaking news. As a consequence, it has become riddled with mis- and disinformation, and journalism has become less able to counter it. The number of journalists has continued to fall. In just the last few months, we've seen BuzzFeed News close down, layoffs announced at Vice News, CNN, and the Washington Post. Job cuts in news media in the UK and North America are currently running at 1,000 per month. But before you can tackle a problem, you need to understand it. And I'd love to talk to you about the history of how we got here through the medium of 8 pieces of breaking news. Let's kick off with one for the ages. There are man bats living on the moon. Let me take you back to the New York Sun in 1835. It ran a series of articles by Sir John Herschel about his discovery of life on the moon. The articles claimed that Sir John, the most famous astronomer of the day, had been observing the moon with a powerful new telescope and had seen strange creatures living on its surface, including unicorns, tailless beavers, and man-bat hybrids. Sir John had seen no such things, and he wasn't delighted when people started to come up to him and ask for more information about the man-bats. But the story had served its purpose. Sales of the New York Sun rocketed as readers were caught up in what later became known as the Great Moon Hoax. 40 years later, in 1874, the New York Herald told its terrified readers that dangerous animals had escaped from Central Park Zoo, killing 49 people and injuring over 200. A lion and a tiger had been spotted fighting on 59th Street. A sea lion had been seen punching a rhinoceros. An anaconda had attempted to eat a giraffe. And a panther had attacked worshippers at the church. At the very end of the article, in very small print, it was stated that the entire story given above is a pure fabrication. The story caused widespread panic. Parents rushed to schools to take their children home, where they were protected by fathers with loaded shotguns. The Herald sold a lot of newspapers. So there's nothing new about using our news ecosystem to monetize shocking and incorrect information. But of course, these days, it's no longer just news organizations that break the news. When Amy Winehouse died in 2011, 20 million people were talking about it on social media before a single news organization had published a story on it. But it wasn't just individuals on social media who began reporting on news stories. Unhindered by the need to verify facts, consult experts, or comply with media law, countless information sources began pumping out news stories for free online, bringing in revenue through click-based advertising. This proliferation of information sources had a powerful effect on the funding of traditional news journalism. Online advertising rates came down as countless new advertising opportunities opened up for marketers. Print advertising went down as advertisers moved online. And print sales plummeted because an entire generation of readers had been educated that they should get their news for free immediately online. The industry that was charged with holding power to account and exposing misinformation was decimated. It had lost its role as gatekeeper of the news. Major news organizations with 100-year pedigrees started laying off journalists, clearing out the sub-editors' desks, reducing freelance pay, and diminishing the scope and ambition of their work. The new online economic model militated against in-depth, long-form journalism. In June 2016, Mother Jones published an extraordinary 35,000-word investigative story about the American prison system. It took 18 months to create, including 4 months that the journalist Shane Bauer spent undercover as a prison guard in a private prison. It uncovered some worrying abuses of power and helped lead to changes in government policy. All in all, it cost them $350,000 to put together. But the banner ads placed alongside the article online raised only $5,000, despite more than 1 million people reading it. It's incredibly difficult to do proper, well-researched, in-depth journalism when people expect online news to be free. The sort of stories that flourish in this environment are short and provocative, turned out in very little time by overworked journalists with no opportunity to seek expert opinion. They race to get news stories out without time for verification or depth. There's even a perverse new incentive for being first rather than being right. At a national level, the effect of these changes on news organizations was devastating, but it was nothing compared to the effect on local news. In 2018, I visited my hometown of Salisbury to report on the aftermath of the Novichok poisonings. I went to the offices of the Salisbury Journal, founded in 1729, where they had one of those old-fashioned boards up where people would put their name cards in to show that they were at the office. There was room for 100 names, and in times gone by, the board would have been almost full. The current occupancy was 5, and between them, they were making 3 newspapers, the Salisbury Journal, the Andover Advertiser, and the Basingstoke Gazette. The editor, then aged 32, spent several weeks of his life at the heart of the biggest story in the world before resuming his unglamorous and difficult work, scrutinizing local politicians and business people with minimal resources. The traditional underpinnings of local news journalism, classified advertising, and people buying printed newspapers had been destroyed by the internet. In the UK, the value of the regional newspaper advertising market has fallen from 2.4 billion in the mid-noughties to £241 million now, a drop of 90%. Between 2005 and 2020, 270 local newspapers shut down in the UK, and this was a pattern repeated across the world. Back in 2009, in an interview with The Guardian, David Simon, a former crime reporter on the Baltimore Sun and the creator of The Wire, summed it up beautifully. Oh, to be a state or local official in America in the next 10 to 15 years before somebody figures out the business model, he said. To gamble freely across the wastelands of an American city as a local politician. It's got to be one of the great dreams in the history of American corruption. It's 14 years since he gave that quote, and we still haven't figured out the model. There's another, more insidious side to this too. Without flourishing local newspapers, the traditional pathway for eager new journalists is cut off. It used to be that you'd start at a local newspaper, cut your teeth writing some stories, be looked after by a kindly editor, and gradually start to work your way up to nationals. This pathway is now gone. And while there's no shortage of new journalism graduates, there aren't any jobs for them to go to. So eventually they become disheartened and go into other careers. And now we have ChatGPT. Picture the potential scene at a newsroom in the not-too-distant future. Overnight, the algorithms have monitored what's trending online. They then set the AI to work, writing stories and columns about them by synthesizing other news stories and columns. The news organization floods its sites and social media with the stories, the money comes in from the advertising clicks, and the few remaining journalists are set to work tweaking the headlines to make them more provocative. The algorithms that govern the internet serve up more of the same to social media news consumers. The news eats itself. And amidst the wash of new, cheaply produced content, misinformation slips ever more easily through the gaps. It was in 2016, 180 years after the Manbats incident, that the term fake news really took off. BuzzFeed News ran a story about a group of enterprising teenagers in Macedonia who had started churning out nonsensical but provocative stories like the one about Pope Francis in the run-up to the US election. They posted them on sites that were designed to look like mainstream news sites, and they made money from the clicks they received. Stories like these were also published by partisan news operations and online groups who gained status and popularity from spreading the lies. Now that everyone could feed into the same information supersystem, the words of a naughty Macedonian teenager, or a swivel-eyed nutjob in a garage in northern Michigan, or a pro-Kremlin stooge in Woking, would be superficially placed on a par with those of the economics editor of the Times. And in fact, the economics editor of the Times would be on the back foot because they would have a duty in their reporting to conduct research, triple-check facts, give context, and not crowbar in the celebrity references and nakedly provocative headlines that would help their stories cut through on the internet. In July of 2018, the UK's Culture Secretary Committee described fake news as a crisis in our democracy. When you can't tell what's real and what's not, the underpinnings of our society start to crumble away. Some news organizations have noticed that polarizing stories cut through online and have actively set about identifying audience of people with firm but misguided beliefs and confirming their prejudices rather than bringing them the truth. Natural human traits, including the desire to band together in groups, make the spreading of misinformation more likely. And this misinformation can have powerful real-world consequences. A lie about 5G towers spreading COVID-19, along with many other conspiracy theories spread during the pandemic, was fueled by a simple human need to have privileged information in a time of crisis. It led, in the UK, to posses of misinformed citizens going out and burning 77 5G towers in the misguided belief in the first month of the pandemic that they were spreading coronavirus. There's a quote that I think helps explain this mad behavior by American biologist Edward O. Wilson, who said, "The real problem of humanity is the following. We have Paleolithic emotions, medieval institutions, and godlike technology." I think this really helps us to understand how lies spread online in the guise of news. Our Paleolithic emotions lead us to search for answers that resonate with our worldview rather than those backed up by facts. Our godlike technology allows us to spread nonsense in seconds to anybody around the world who's prepared to buy it. This is aided by the 60% of people who shared stories online before reading past the headline because it chimes with their ideology, their beliefs, or their emotions, or makes them feel intelligent or in control. And our medieval institutions are ill-equipped to deal with or regulate this scary new world. The speed with which our technology works led spooked investors to pull $42 billion out of Silicon Valley Bank in a matter of hours in March this year, causing a run on a financial institution which nearly triggered a repeat of the global financial crash of 2008. Meanwhile, the influence of anti-vaccine falsehoods online led to thousands of fit young people dying needlessly and remorsefully of COVID-19. But what's prompting the propagation of all of this nonsense? Oddly enough, part of the problem is Psy of Gangnam Style fame. For a long time, YouTube's suggestions algorithm worked by serving up videos that were similar to the one that you'd watch but more popular, All roads notionally then led to 2012 hit Gangnam Style, the most popular video on YouTube. In 2015, the algorithm was changed to serve up more niche content to help smaller videos and producers get views. The problem is that this helped create YouTube rabbit holes, where instead of being elevated upwards towards Gangnam Style, you were drawn downwards to conspiracy theories and extreme viewpoints spread by crackpots. On TikTok, the fastest growing news source among UK adults, such theories and viewpoints are rife. In the recent case of the death of the 45-year-old mortgage advisor and mother of two, Nicola Bulley, for example, the site was flooded with disturbing and damaging misinformation by amateur detectives. But of course, it's not just reprehensible and daft normal people spreading lies. The corruption of the information system goes right to the top. Breaking news. Rishi Sunak doesn't think adults convicted of sexually assaulting children should go to prison. Of course he does. But this untrue claim recently circulated online next to a picture of the Prime Minister and his signature. It was issued on behalf of the opposition Labour Party, and it was seen 21 million times online in the first 3 days. My magazine is firmly non-partisan, and of course there are any number of lies by the British Conservative politicians that could be highlighted here too, over oven-ready Brexit deals, Partygate, borders in the Irish Sea, new hospitals, to name just a few. The thing that shocks me about this particular lie is it's so entirely transparent. The person who designed the advert must know it's a lie. Keir Starmer, the man most likely to become our next Prime Minister, must know it's a lie. He must also know that the lie is based on data about convictions stretching back to 2010, 5 years before Rishi Sunak even entered the House of Commons. He must further be aware that until 2013, he himself was the Director of Public Prosecutions and consequently much more able to affect sentencing guidelines than Rishi Sunak. But ultimately, it doesn't matter whether it's true or not. It just matters whether enough people believe it's true or feel that the waters have been muddied sufficiently that they don't know what to believe. The people who get angry about it on social media are playing into the campaign's hands by helping them to spread it. And unreality starts to seep in. Most of the people in this room spend a lot of time thinking about the media and how it works. But for the majority of people who don't, the information ecosystem we've built up for ourselves can feel like walking around a hall of mirrors filled with vaping monkeys. Of course, the Labour campaign's fib pales in comparison to the work of Donald J. Trump. When the 45th president of the United States took up office, the Washington Post began tracking every provable untruth that he told. By the time he left office, it stood at 30,573. One of these, that he had been cheated out of victory in the 2020 election, has already claimed the lives of five people in the storming of the Capitol and its aftermath, and is likely to corrupt US civic and political life for years to come. He was aided in it by Fox News, which recently agreed to pay Dominion almost $800 million to settle a defamation lawsuit over its coverage of claims of vote rigging. Trump's real coup de grace, however, was not just a lie, but to describe any stories he didn't like as fake news. Among others, he declared that ABC, the BBC, CBS, CNN, MSNBC, NBC, the New York Times, the Wall Street Journal, and the Washington Post were all producers of fake news. This is a blatant, childish, and effective trick. Somebody tells the truth about your disinformation, and then you say that the truth itself is disinformation. The clouds of bullshit-flavoured vape grow ever thicker in the Hall of Mirrors. And that's before we even get to China and Russia. I want you to lay down your arms and surrender to the Russians. This is a chilling thing to hear Volodymyr Zelensky say. Or at least it would be, if it weren't being delivered by an implausible deepfake of Zelensky, whose head is too big for his body and appears to be floating slightly above his neck. This cack-handed piece of propaganda was more worrying as a harbinger of the future than a genuine piece of disinformation. But when deepfakes are perfected and accessible to everyone, all bets are off. The few remaining journalists will have to spend much of their time trying to work out which footage is for real and which is not. Given how quickly content can go viral online, we can expect reputations to be shredded, lawsuits to be launched, and wars to be intensified in the time it takes to work it out. The other side of deepfake video is that it will give plausible deniability to chances. If you're part of a despicable video from now on, for example, one in which you brag about sexually assaulting women, you can cash in the liar's dividend, meaning you can just claim the video is a deepfake, make it other people's problem to prove that it's true. Inject enough of this nonsense into the news system and you accelerate people's distrust of it. Perhaps it's unsurprising that so many people are now simply turning away from the news. So 38% of people around the world actively avoid the news. This is a figure from a Reuters survey, and it's gone up from 29% in 2017. In the UK, it stands at 46% of people actively avoiding the news. This is probably unsurprising. We've all begun carrying around devices that can ping us constant updates from news sources and social media, drawing our focus and attention and making us anxious about problems that we have no real chance of solving. Instead of engaging us in optimistic conversations about the future or helping us to work towards solutions, they drag us from one helpless crisis to another. But nor should we despair. Breaking news may be broken, but it's not a hopeless situation. There are lots of things we can do to gain a healthier, more sustainable relationship with the news. We can teach our kids to be skeptical and deliberate in their news consumption, not to forward stories without reading them, and to spot when a friend is disappearing down a disinformation rabbit hole and try to bring them back. We can support big news organizations that bring important stories to light, winning trust over many years of mainly getting things right and apologizing when they get things wrong. We can support small local news initiatives battling to survive and the exciting new initiatives like the Manchester Mill in the UK, which are pioneering new models of local journalism. We can support fact-checking organisations after first checking that they are not astroturf fronts for belligerent nations or businesses with special agendas. We can support small independent magazines like Delayed Gratification in their mission to give context and perspective to the news. In championing slow journalism, my fellow editors and I have tried to swim against the tide. Breaking news is obsessed with being first. We are proud to be, and it's written down the side, last to breaking news. Not covering major events until at least 3 months later and aiming to bring context and perspective to help our readers to understand the world. Breaking news is powered by overwhelming streams of constantly updated content, while we curate and edit, distilling the moments that mattered into 120 pages every 3 months. Breaking news is often funded by giving away content to the biggest possible audience and then monetizing those people through invasive advertising and selling their data. My magazine carries no advertising and has no sinister multimillionaire backer, but we've been able to fund ambitious investigations in challenging countries across the world. In a recent issue, for example, we reported from Turkey on the aftermath of the earthquakes, following up on a vital story that had dropped from the news agenda. We're now actively looking to spread our journalism internationally by working with new licensing partners to bring slow journalism to a wider audience. We need to call on as many different models as we can find to fund an army of ambitious, inquisitive journalists who spend their days hunting down the truth, checking the facts and holding the powerful to account. That will, of course, require people who value the truth to put their hands in their pockets. Together, I hope we can start to navigate our way out of the smoky hall of mirrors, dodging deepfakes, discounting disinformation and speaking truth to power as we go. Maybe some of the answers will be uncovered here this week. I do hope so. Thank you very much.
And thank you, Rob, for your insightful presentation. So now we have some room for questions and a discussion. And Rob, I'd like to ask you to take
Very
a seat.
Very good, thank you.
So we can discuss these topics with Rob. There's the first one. I'm going to use a microphone for this because there will be a recording. So I'd like to ask you all, if you have a question, please talk in this weird square thing. And then we'll be all right. All right, here you go.
Okay.
Yes, take it away.
That's ridiculous microphone.
So, Rob, thank you very much. And I especially appreciate the last part when you mentioned like what we can do as individuals. So I think it's very important because that was my first thing. It's like, well, what can I really do? So thanks indeed for giving that hint.
Otherwise, it's quite a depressing talk, isn't it?
Exactly.
It's like 95% very depressing. Yeah.
Thank you for that. My next question is, what do you think would be the role of, let's say, content creator, because I wouldn't even call them news writer, right?
Yeah.
Anybody can become a news writer at this point, right? So what would be the role of content creators and policymakers in all this?
Wow, that's fascinating. I guess the big battleground, so one thing I've noticed from being here is that obviously the big thing that people are talking about is AI. And I guess that that's the next massive restructuring that's going to happen to our industry, isn't it? That's the thing that's going to pick all the pieces up and throw them in the air again. So in terms of regulation, I guess there's a huge amount to be discussed there, like the parameters within which you can operate. Obviously, a lot of people aren't going to operate in those parameters, you know, no matter, but if you've got them there, that's kind of interesting. And I do think also that there's an opportunity for content creators, for news journalists, to sort of proudly say that they are not following the rest of the herd and, you know, chasing AI and using AI and clearing out their newsrooms, you know, and automating and so on. And I think that there's going to be a premium that is placed on human-made content. I think that's going to be increasingly big. So I guess anything that regulators can do to help facilitate that will be good. And maybe anything that the content creators can do to slipstream into that new thing might be interesting.
Thanks.
You can throw it to me.
Oh, okay. Oh, that's brilliant.
I'm looking forward to throwing it up.
Thank you so much for your question, first one. Are there any other questions or maybe thoughts you want to share with Rob? Yes, okay, I'm going to throw this thing
at you. Oh, wow, look at that, right at the back.
Okay. You didn't record that, right? Can you give it to... Thank you.
Okay, thanks, Rob. I'd love to hear more about the slow journalism, how you handle a subject. For example, you said something about going to Turkey after everything is settled, maybe after 3 months. What kind of stories would you bring, and how could it be still important, and what kind of audience? I want to know more about how you handle it practically.
Yes, of course. So this is a really good question. So what we like to do is we like to work with journalists who are within a country, usually ones who have been covering a story. So, for example, like the earthquakes in Turkey. So we had a journalist based in Istanbul, and she had immediately... So she was working for NOS, and she had immediately set out after the earthquakes to kind of go and go to the affected areas and see what's happening. And what we were able to do was also to ask her to go back several months afterwards. And what happens when you do that is you get a very interesting story that very rarely gets picked up by the rest of the media. So you get to see whether all of the promises that politicians made about rebuilding have actually started to kind of come to fruition. You've been able to get people's settled opinion about the politics of the situation. So what generally tends to happen is a big news story happens. Everybody in the world kind of descends on that place. They cover it 24/7 for a few days, and then it goes off the news agenda. So what you get is the same people being interviewed over and over and over. And in some cases, those people may be in a state of shock. You know, they may be still trying to process their emotions from a massive, great, big event that's taken place. So one of the nice things about slow journalism is you get a slower, more considered response. You get to follow up and see what's happened. You also, from a practical point of view, quite often get better access. So I remember with the Salisbury story, for example, with the Novichok poisonings. So my small hometown of Salisbury became this epicenter. And I remember there was this this point at which it was very difficult to cross the market square without being interviewed by a journalist from somewhere. And there's this amazing bit of video of this old man, and he's just walking across the square with a stick, and somebody stops him and says, "Can I ask you a question? Are you really scared?" And the guy said, "Don't talk nonsense," and just kind of walked on. But the nice thing is when you go back afterwards, it's just a much more real situation. So there's all sorts of advantages. Those would be the big sorts of stories that we cover. And then the other sort of story that we cover is stories where there's ongoing developments, but they presuppose a huge amount of information. So one of them, for example, in the new issue, is about Northern Ireland. And the way that Northern Ireland is reported in the UK, there's such a wealth of history that you need to know in order to make sense of what's going on now. So this is the sort of story on the 25th anniversary of the Good Friday Agreement. We send the journalist there for a couple of weeks, and she really speaks to lots of people about the Troubles and about the aftermath of the Troubles, about the current political tensions. And you get the sort of story that just doesn't have a place in other media outlets.
That's amazing. Thank you. Other questions, maybe?
Can I ask one more question? I want to know how you can make it affordable, or how can you say it? Dat het gewoon, zeg maar, te betalen is.
Yes. So how do we make it work economically?
Yeah.
It's very difficult. It's very difficult. But we're there now. We've got to a nice stage. So we don't have advertisers. We don't have sponsors. We've just got readers. Subscriptions. It's a subscription model. Exactly. Yeah. So we have about 8,500 subscribers paying an average of £60 each a year. And then we do classes for subscribers. We sell back issues. We sell merchandise and things like that. And we make it work. We can fund some good and ever increasingly ambitious news journalism with that. Yeah. So a subscriptions model.
A question about this one. The audience you're targeting, what kind of profile is it?
Do you know, I have a very bad answer to this. So most media organizations have got a very good idea of who their audience are. And I know that that's like, that's media 101. But we've always slightly made, made this point that unlike other media organizations, we don't want to be bothering our readers. So we've never really done that kind of deep, granular insight into who they are, because we're not selling advertising. So we don't need to sell their profiles. And partly, also, this is a magazine where we have kind of bloody-mindedly made the magazine that we want to read and hope that readers coalesce around it. Now, I know that does sound absolutely ridiculous, but that's the honest answer. And I think, honestly, also, that's how the best magazines are made, not by having a kind of a profile in mind. I need to have something in here for the ABC ones and something for the 2030s and something for this and that and the other. I don't think you can fake that for the amount of time that you need to do in order for a project like this to work economically. So all I know about our readers is them getting in touch and asking about the magazine. So when I meet them at events and things like that, but I couldn't tell you a huge amount about them.
Okay, thank you. Is your question answered?
Yeah.
Thank you. You can keep the microphone and throw it maybe to the guy in the middle there. I hope it will work out.
This is amazing.
Thank you.
Love it. That's
lovely. Great grills.
Thank you for your presentation. What's your goal for the coming years for slow journalism, and how do you plan to get there?
That's a nice question. That's a nice question. I like that. Lots of stuff. Podcasts, documentaries, foreign language editions. We're about to launch an app. And I think that means that we can then open ourselves up to doing some really nice foreign licensing, because actually we'll have the entire setup. So we'll have like the digital component, we'll have the print component if people want it, we'll have all of the back end, we'll have all that stuff. More books. So we've done a book already. We did a beautiful book of infographics. We've got another book that's coming out next year. I think, honestly, more of the same. And, you know, we don't have big budgets. So we just did this advertising campaign on the London Underground. And this for us was a massive big step. But I want to do more of that. I mean, actually, what we're trying to do is move out of the arena of kind of small independent magazines that, you know, look pretty but are going to die off quite quickly, and into the kind of like somewhere between that and the mainstream, I think, and then kind of maintain that and keep growing. And also survive in this, and I'm sorry to say it again because I've been talking to people about it this morning, but survive in this new era of AI-powered journalism, which absolutely freaks me out. I think it's going to be petrifying.
Nightmares.
Yes, it is nightmare time. It is. Yeah.
Maybe one follow-up.
Yes.
I think in the Netherlands we have two outlets who do similar things like you do, like the correspondent.
This correspondent, yeah.
Follow the Money. Do you share lessons with them also? And
Really like the correspondent, and I remember being at an event with somebody from the correspondent early on, and they were talking about their numbers, and it's a very similar philosophy. And their numbers were so impressive, and it was such a great kind of thing. So, I look on with great admiration at what they've done. I think that's fantastic, and I think you're exactly right. And there are, you know, there are kind of people doing similar projects around the place.
Yeah. Thank you. Other questions? Yes.
Thank you so much, also for your initiative, your great magazine. I was wondering, how will you be able to fight against the social media and the fake news? I mean, I can imagine that you have an audience that's inside their own bubble,
yep.
So you will not be able to reach the bubble in which fake news is going round and round and round.
Yeah, yeah.
So how will you be able to...
Well,
work your way around that.
I think I've got two
maybe
answers to that. Yeah. So number one is we won't reach most people who are stuck in kind of fake news bubbles. We just won't. This is always a niche kind of product. It's always going to kind of remain niche. So we can't break into a lot of those. However, I do think that something I've noticed that hadn't started when we launched the magazine was people becoming sick of their phones, realizing that their phones are sucking away their life and their time and their money. I don't know if it kind of happens to you guys, but sometimes I'm there at night just before I go to sleep, and I find myself like aimlessly stabbing away at stuff on my phone because like somewhere in there's an answer to a question and I don't even know what the fucking question is. And it's just, it's ridiculous. So it sucks the life away.
You get a lot of notifications during the day, right?
I mean, like you could, if you want to keep on top of the news these days, genuinely like have an attempt at keeping on top of the news, that's a full-time occupation. When I was born in 1980, like, you could kind of get up, you could read a newspaper, you could maybe listen to the news on the radio
on
the way in.
You could have a life, right?
You could have a life. And then if you were really into the news, you could watch the 10 o'clock bulletin before bed. Now, you could just be constantly going all the time, and you still wouldn't be on top of what's going on. But I think people get sick of it. And I think when they do, then operations like mine actually can be there to kind of provide a little bit of an antidote, something calmer, something that gives them a screen break, something that takes them back to that thing of having an artifact and it's finished and you can read it and then you sit there and you feel informed, rather than the internet, which is obviously infinite and goes on forever. So I think we won't reach most people, but I think the faster things get, the more of an impetus there is for people to pick up things like this magazine.
Was that the main reason you started the magazine back in, I think, 2011? It's
like, yes. Yeah. Yes, it was exactly that. We were looking out across the media landscape, and everybody, I'm sure you remember this, but back in 2010, 2011, everyone was saying digital is the answer. Like, print is dead. Digital is the answer. But nobody had worked out, like, a funding model, really. And I'm not sure that, you know, some people have come, like, The Correspondent has done really well, but nobody's really worked out a conclusive funding model still for really good journalism. And so it was that anxiety. So the group of people who set this up, there were five of us journalists and one art director. And in retrospect, that was quite a stupid way to launch a company, because we didn't have anybody who knew about, like, marketing or PR subscriptions or VAT returns or anything like that. And we've had to learn it as we go along. But actually, it was a group of journalists just being like, this is really scary what's happening now. We need to do like our very small bit to say that it's not right.
But Rob, how did you do it? Because independent magazines die after like 3 issues, I guess.
Yeah.
It's been 10 years. Congrats on your 10th anniversary. That's quite something.
Yeah.
Without advertisers, without stealing our data. What is your secret?
Yeah. No, well, just being prepared to put up with some very hard times, I think, at the beginning. So when we launched this, my wife and I were both working freelance. And so we ended up working kind of in evenings and weekends and then just dedicating the week to making the magazine happen. And then I think probably, you know, like most of the people here are probably involved in media projects where you just, like, you feel compelled, right? There's a bee in your bonnet. You just want to do it. You just kind of keep doing it. And I think that's it, isn't it? Like, there's an old quote, which is like 90% of success is turning up. You just got to keep turning up. And, you know, it's not like we're suddenly, like, we don't have the answer. It's not like we're making millions of pounds a year. And, you know, it's like it's all kind of perfect and easy. It's still, you know, you still got to keep going.
But is it a magazine for the happy few?
Well, that's interesting. Well, potentially, but it's not that expensive. So, you know, if you're
How
in
much?
The UK, you can spend £48 a year and you can get 480 pages, exclusive journalism, no advertising. You've got access to 13 years of kind of past content. You get discounts on amazing classes that get taught online and so on. So actually, I mean, £48 buys you sort of 3 pints of beer in London these days. So, you know, it's not a... I don't think it's a fortune, to be honest with you. I don't think it's exclusive.
Thank you. Audience, do you have any questions left? Yeah. Yeah, thank you.
Yeah, hi, just a question. In your keynote, you made a link between fake news and news avoidance.
And news avoidance, yeah.
Yeah, news avoidance. The institute I work for, Utrecht University of Applied Sciences, did some research. It turned out that the predominant negative nature of news is a far more bigger factor in news avoidance than fake news.
Yeah.
What's your view on that?
I'm certain that that's true. Yes, I think because the issues that we're reporting on, the really important issues that we're reporting on, a lot of the time feel hopeless. I mean, anything to do with the climate, you know. You get to a stage where you're just like, this is, you're keeping me at this level of shock and suspense and horror and upset all the time. But there's nothing, I have no agency around this. I can't recycle any more than I do. I can't, you know, like do any more than I do, whatever it is. So I'm certain that that's the case. I'm certain that there's just kind of background drumbeat of existential dread, war in Ukraine, you know, lots of things kind of like inflation, cost of living, like, demographics, all of these things. It's just, you go onto the news site and it's just terribly upsetting. I'm certain that's making people switch off. But I'm also fascinated by the extent to which people's confidence in the news has plummeted. So we did this event a few years ago in London We did an infographic. We love doing infographics. In fact, anybody who fancies coming up afterwards and have a look at the magazine, I've got some copies of the magazine. I've got our book up there. So we did this infographic, and we just put it up on the wall, like a big cross like this, and we asked people to track their age against their trust in the media, in all sorts of different types of media. And I was astonished by the sort of people who were saying that they had very low trust in institutions like the BBC. I remember talking to a lady, and she was in her 60s, like a nice middle-class, well-to-do lady. And I said, so would you put your thing for the BBC right down here? And she said, yeah, you can't trust anything by anybody anymore, can you? And I think that fake news has got to be linked to that. This kind of, it's a bit like politicians, you know, you get a few corrupt ones, and they say, oh, they're all the same. Like, you get a few fake news stories, like, oh, it's all the same, and the whole thing gets thrown out in one go.
Thank you. So, but how do you see the role of slow journalism in this addressing the growing mistrust of the audience? I mean, what are the key takeaways we should take from your speech today?
Well, so I think there's a series of things. It's not the answer in by any stretch of the imagination, but I think it's one of the answers. It's allowing people to reflect on big stories after the media kind of buzz has happened. It's giving them a follow-up to the stories, which they very, very rarely have. It's hopefully giving them the kind of the deep background context and perspective to the stories. It's being straightforward about not having advertising, so not being beholden to advertisers, not endorsing anything that they think is nonsensical. And I think those are all measures that will hopefully help to make something more trusted. But again, all you can do is you've got to keep at it for a long period of time, because trust is won over a very long period of time and then it's lost immediately, isn't it? Mm.
Doing slow journalism, is it like more an attitude or more a skill set you have to have as a journalist?
I think it's, honestly, I think this idea of kind of slow journalism just boils down to good journalism fundamentally. And it's this idea of, you know, like slow travel, slow food, is the idea about taking your time to do something that's got higher quality to it. And I think this is about slow journalism. It's just allowing journalists more than 10 minutes to get a story out, you know, allowing them to go back and take time and research and speak to lots of experts and canvas opinion and so on. So I think it's probably a set of skills, but it's a set of skills that sometimes gets lost in this rush to get stories out and to get content out as fast as possible and to follow what is trending online.
Regarding taking a step back in the research process, slow journalism is often involves long-term articles, research, but some might argue that this doesn't align with the younger audiences,
right,
who are very short attention span, who have a very short attention span, who are more interested in news bites on social media and updates like that. So how can slow journalism be more of use to this particular audience?
I wish I had a good answer to that, but I don't.
Oh.
And I don't think it's that it's not limited to young people, is it? I'm sure everybody in this room, as well as me, finds that their attention span is pathetic these days. And, you know, you'd start to read something engrossing and interesting, but you're also aware of your kind of phone is like there and something might happen or something might be really important. So it's not I don't think it's a young person problem. I think it's a humans with technology problem. But I don't think that you can cater to that. You've got to just kind of keep doing the thing that you think is important, and again hope that the kind of the audience aggregates around that, because otherwise there's nothing kind of special or different about it. It's just more of the same.
Mm. Okay, thank you. Yes. Oh, I just heard we don't have any time left. Maybe after, with a drink, you can speak to Rob Orchard.
That'd be lovely.
Excuse me for this.
That'd be lovely, and also, just a little plug, if any of you would like to go and take a subscription to this wonderful magazine, use that code, Dutch15, and you'll get 15% off.
Very smart. Thank you, Rob. Thank you for your answer.
Your lipstick.